Singapore is developing its capabilities. It has gradually become a blue water navy, but a lot of people are wondering what kind of a navy force we are trying to build. What is the aim of Chinese navy development?
I believe that the Chinese want to build its navy into such a force which can match its mission. One is to protect the maritime interest and the territorial integrity. Second is to perform more international obligations and perform those missions like peacekeeping operations, protection of the safety and the security of sea lanes of communication, and other missions like the search and the rescue, which is being performed right now at the Bay of Thailand.
We have already broken, as Dong Ning mentioned, the first island chain, as is often referred to, from Japan to Taiwan to Philippines. Is this the limit that our Navy will go, or will go even further?
I think several conditions decide that the Chinese Navy will have to do that. One is that we are developing our blue water Navy. Second is the fact that if we are carrying out this sort of exercises on drilling in the disputed maritime area, I think Japan will propose that we will present a protest against us. Therefore, we are going to the high sea to carry out the military drills. Thirdly, I think the Chinese military will have to familiarize itself with the territory, with the water conditions there, so that, and the wave conditions there, so that tide conditions there, so that they can perform missions when they are asked by the international community.
Let's talk about the weaponry of the Navy. Of course, we have already our first aircraft carrier. The aircraft carrier is just the beginning of the build-up of maybe more fleets. What kind of a carrier fleet we're looking at? Maybe one, two, three?
It's very interesting. People pay, I think, I'm afraid, they pay too much attention on this, you know, testing, you know, aircraft carriers. It's something, not something new, high-tech weapons, you know. It's come to the world 100 years ago. We just have one. And if you only have one aircraft carrier, it will not have the necessary, you know, the required combating capabilities. We need more, at least, you know, according to the naval experts, I think it is three aircraft carrier groups rather than, you know, three carriers. One is in operation, the other is for training, the other one is for maintenance and also test or something like that. So from this point of view, we still, you know, have a long way to go to even make this one single aircraft carrier to be capable to implement the fighting missions for China. So it's a long way to go.
Another thing is, I think the Americans are worried is that China has been developing capabilities to deny access for the American Navy ships, like anti-ship missiles or fast-moving ships carrying cruise missiles. Are they what we are looking at? That is the development of China's own version of Monroe Doctrine.
I don't think we are doing that, because I don't think we are. We need to do that, because that's the interpretation of the Americans, some of the Americans. I think development of the Navy capabilities of China is mainly intended to protect security of our own and perform those missions as I mentioned just now. I don't think they are intended for the war against U.S. Warships, U.S. Navy in Western Pacific.
One more point on that?
Yes.
It's very ironic, you know. On one hand, the Americans, you know, the government openly declared that they will have the legitimacy or the commitment to defend, you know, so-called Taiwan, you know, and also his so-called allies. But at the same time, he wants to deny the Chinese a legitimate right to defend themselves. I think that's very ironic. It's really difficult to understand why they have such a kind of mentality. I think because of they have in their mind, they have an underlying assumption that China is a potential adversary or possible enemy. if they change this kind of underlying assumptions, if they perceive China as a possible partner, you know, for implementing other kind of missions for peacekeeping, for HIA, you know, search and rescues, or even for, you know, commonly maintain regional stabilities, I think they will not worry about the Chinese military development.
What do we make
of the mindset problem?
What do we make of the recent military sparrings between the two militaries? For example, the 2009 U.S.'s impeccable surveillance ship have a standout with a Chinese ship, and recently our carrier, Liaoning carrier, had a face-off with a U.S. vessel. Will this kind of a standoff be a norm in the future, because we don't want the U.S. military surrounding our territory in the vicinity of our coastal areas?
Actually, China and the United States have got different understanding, or different interpretation of the UNCLOS. For example, the innocent passage. We don't believe that the reconnaissance against China is the innocent passage. And secondly, if we look at the situation that the Liaoning group is carrying out a drill on South China Sea, but their ships is waging itself, one ship is waging itself into the formation of our warship. Of course, that is very, very dangerous. So we have to take some reactive actions.
So the U.S. is trying to swagger its forces, and the Chinese has appropriate response.
I think so, because of the language, right? Therefore, because we speak Chinese and we seldom speak English, therefore the facts were not publicized openly to the outside from the Chinese side. Mm. So that's the problem.
So they got the voices more on the international narrative.
Yes, that's
right. Thank
you.
You're now watching Voices and Votes here on CCTV News. And